Listening to the Eye of the Time, I'm Pooh.
And I'm William Cooper.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
You know what?
What?
Every time you do that, I just fall more and more in love with you than I ever was before.
Oh, Lord, I just can't wait until my birthday.
Oh, well, how did that subject come up?
Know which day it is?
I know which day it is, but I'm not going to say which day it is. I want to know, how did that subject come up?
Well, I just know when it came.
I think you're on a fishing expedition, and I'm not going to let you get away with that. So, it's time for you to go to bed.
I know when your birthday is.
Well, I don't want you to fish on that expedition either. Okay?
Bye.
Bye-bye, baby. I'll see you later. Where in the world does it come from? If you are wondering what happened last night, some kind of technical difficulties, they tell me, kept us off the satellite. I was supposed to get a call from the people who run this satellite network today explaining to me what happened, and nobody called. So, I don't know why or what went wrong, but that's twice in a row that everybody before this broadcast was fine on the satellite, and then when it came time for this broadcast, we couldn't get on the uplink, and of course, the old disinformation show that follows this broadcast had no problem whatsoever. So I'm going to get to the bottom of it. I don't know how, but I'm going to do that. We're coming up very shortly, ladies and gentlemen, to the fourth anniversary of the Hour of the Time, which will occur this Saturday. Since it occurs Saturday, we're going to start tonight and just go through Monday night talking to you, talking about the Hour of the Time for the last 4 years, playing some good music, and all kinds of stuff. We can talk about whatever you want. I don't care. But not going to get into anything too serious. Not going to bust anything doing research for a broadcast on the next 4 nights because it's sort of a celebration for us. You see, we weren't ever sure that we would last 3 days, much less 4 years. And Saturday, May 4th, it will be exactly 4 years telling the truth on the air, documenting it so that you could research it and verify it. And boy, we have awakened an awful lot of people, probably more than anyone in the history of the world has ever awakened. And it's mainly due to the fact that we document what we say, that we don't care if we have ratings, that we don't even care if you like us, but that we do care about the truth, and that the truth gets spoken, and that it gets not just spoken, but documented, that we don't allow rumors on this broadcast, that we don't put up with the sheeple factor. We have no patience for ignorance, stupidity, apathy, all of the things that have brought this country to the brink of absolute disaster. And we're going to continue that way. We're going to continue mainly for the people who are awakened, and I understand that even though we're not really trying to get to the sheeple anymore like we did for the first 3 years, that we are getting new listeners all the time, and that they are absolutely amazed at what they're hearing, they are at a disadvantage because we're not going back to square one and start all over again to educate them from the kindergarten level. They have to play catch up on their own. We do provide a good catalog of back tapes from which they can draw up on in order to increase their knowledge in these areas. And folks, I am extremely happy that we have made it this far. I don't know how much farther we're going to make it, but it amazes me that we have reached, or will reach, 4 years Saturday. Of course, we won't be broadcasting Saturday, but between Friday and Monday, this will occur. And I am deeply, deeply appreciative and thankful to all of the people who throughout the last 4 years have done even the slightest little bit to make this possible. I don't care how small or how large. I especially owe a debt to the old Becker satellite network that first got me on the air. That didn't work out, neither did the Becker satellite network, but nevertheless, without that start, there would be no Hour of the Time. Our first broadcasts were on satellite only. And I truly, ladies and gentlemen, believe that no one in the world was listening, because I thought you had to have a radio to hear a radio broadcast. And I was taping the broadcast at home, sending them to the Becker satellite network. They were putting them up on the satellite, and it was one of the satellites way down on the horizon. I think it was SpaceNet 2, I believe, all the way down on the horizon. So only some people ever got it. And I was hoping that radio stations looking for broadcasting would pick up the Hour of the Time and rebroadcast it. Well, that never materialized, except for KDNO and a whole bunch of small FM stations across the country. And occasionally, an AM or FM station of the commercial quality type has picked up the Hour of the Time and rebroadcast it. And for some strange reason, occasionally when people have been traveling across the United States, they have heard the Hour of the Time on one particular AM frequency wherever they were at in the whole country. And I don't understand how that happens, but apparently it does. And I'm not going to complain about it, because we've gained an awful lot of listeners for that. For those of you who don't know it, this broadcast, the Hour of the Time, has the largest shortwave radio audience in the world. This show has captured the imagination, the hearts, and the minds, and the at least 1 hour of their time, five nights a week, every week, 52 weeks a year. And I'm also very happy that people have found worth in this broadcast and that they have tuned in every night and listened to it. I get letters, thousands of letters a week, ladies and gentlemen. You would not believe the amount of mail that I get. It is almost impossible to even deal with it. And I get letters from people saying that my broadcast, or this broadcast, literally is their life. They look forward to it. They will not miss it. No matter what, if they go on vacation, they take their shortwave radio with them, and they make sure that when this broadcast comes on, they're listening to it. It is their window on the true facts. You see, no one can listen to broadcast news anymore and get the truth. They can't even fool themselves into thinking they're getting the truth anymore. The establishment media has been 100% completely, totally discredited, and they did it to themselves. They did it to themselves by lying and perpetrating Marxist socialist agendas to destroy this country. And so no one listens to them anymore. No one believes them anymore. You have to be an outright stupid fool to listen to the 6 o'clock news with any of those talking puppet heads that are paid $2 million a year to tell you lies and believe what they say. And the same goes for most of the radio news. Not all, but most. And I am extremely proud that we have stuck by the quality of our documentation and our fact-finding and our refusal to go with rumors and expose rumors and lies and bullshit whenever and wherever it occurs. And, of course, we owe a debt of gratitude to the folks at KDNO in Delano, California, for being brave enough to carry this broadcast. And Richard Palmquist, whether you know it or not, ladies and gentlemen, has withstood the slings and arrows of some of the greatest bullshit artists and hypocrites that exist upon the face of this earth. And he has continued to carry the hour of the time. Even though they've threatened to shut him down and cut off his money and not donate to his station and all kinds of stuff. You see, KDNO is a little station in Delano, California, which really depends upon the goodwill of the listeners for its very existence. Richard Palmquist is a man who really cares about freedom. He cares about this country. He cares about the truth. When he first called me up to ask if he could air my broadcast, I told him, well, anybody can air my broadcast. You don't even have to ask. The only stipulation that I make is that you don't edit any of it. If you want to do a commercial, you got to do it when I play music. Otherwise, you can't do it. You can't cut out my commercial for Swiss America. And so it makes it hard for radio stations to carry this broadcast because I will not be censored. I will not allow the broadcast to be edited or anything to be taken out of context, because you can really be made to look really bad when people do that. And you can be made to say things that you did not say. So I don't allow it. But Richard Palmquist only had one request. He said, Bill, he says, a lot of my listeners are elderly Christian ladies, and they contribute money to the station to keep it on the air so that we can do these kinds of things. I just have one request. And I said, what's that? He says, will you stop using the word BS? Because he wouldn't say bullshit like I will. I said, no, Richard, I won't. I do that to separate the hypocrites from the real people. Because I could get on here and say cockadel toro, or I could say bullpucky, or I could say BS and all of that stuff, and everybody in their mind knows that I'm saying bullshit, and they won't get mad when I do that. But if I say bullshit, they get angry, and that's hypocritical. It's a lie. That's as far as I go with this kind of stuff, because I want people to understand, you know, just how much they fool themselves as much as being fooled by other people. We have to start dealing with reality. We must do that, folks. We've got to look at ourselves. We've got to be able to call a spade a spade, even if it's us. And, you know, my motto has always been, we're going to tell the truth on this show. We're going to do what's necessary to wake and educate the American people, no matter who it helps or hurts, even if it hurts me. And even if it hurts you, it doesn't make any difference. So I told Richard, no. I said, no, if that's the way that your listeners are, if they're really that hypocritical, and if they really don't understand that bullshit is not an obscene word, that it has distinct meaning, it's in the dictionary, it's not in the little dictionaries that most people buy, because most people have never seen a real dictionary. In fact, the real dictionary of the English language, if you want to know the truth, is about 17 volumes, and it's the Oxford English Dictionary. Oxford Dictionary of the English Language, and you would be amazed what's in the dictionary and what the meanings of those words are beyond what you think they are. And many of us are using words with meanings, or at least we think we're using the words for the meanings that we have been indoctrinated into, when those words don't mean those things at all. Our language is being slowly changed, ladies and gentlemen. But anyway, Richard Palmquist bit the bullet. He ran this broadcast anyway. And out of all the controversial things that I've ever done or said on this broadcast, it's exactly like he predicted and exactly like I knew was going to happen. The biggest objection to this broadcast was the word bullshit on KDNO in that area of California. And I have not bent, even though many people have threatened and all kinds of stuff. We broadcast the same as we always have, always will, because people don't understand. I'm not a radio personality. I'm not going to live or die if this station, if this broadcast is on the air or not. It's not going to happen. I don't care if I have ratings. I don't care if I only have one listener or no listeners. What I care about is that I'm doing the right thing and telling the truth. And that's the only thing that matters to me. Nothing else matters. When people call and complain to WWCR about some of the things in this broadcast and threaten to sue and all those kinds of things, and George or somebody calls me, and by the way, we owe another debt of gratitude to WWCR and George and Adam Locke and the people at WRNO who carried us after WWCR was burned to the ground. Of course, Swiss America Trading and all the good people who have helped and contributed and done things to keep this broadcast on the air. But, you know, whenever they would call and say they were going to sue us, I'd say, you guys just don't understand. You know, if you're afraid, then drop my broadcast, because I'm not going to change anything. I will not be censored. I will not stop what I'm doing. Nothing. This broadcast is going to go on, and if it lasts, it lasts. If it doesn't, it doesn't. And there are a lot of people who are absolutely amazed that it has lasted for 4 years, including me. So, and hopefully it will last for 4 years more, although, folks, I wouldn't give you a nickel's chance for that ever happening. But anyway, as long as it's here, we're going to continue to bring you the truth. We're going to document that truth. We're going to talk about things nobody else will talk about. We're going to identify the enemies by name and organizations and dogma and religion of the Constitution and the Bill of Rights and, of course, the United States of America. And we're going to do it as long as we possibly can. Don't go away. I'll be right back, and then we'll take your calls.
If you want something to play with, go and find yourself a star. Baby, my time is too expensive, and I'm not a little boy. Serious. Don't play with my heart, it makes me furious. But if you want me to love you, then a baby I will. Girl, you know I will keep you telling like it is. Let your conscience be your guide. But I know deep down inside of me, I believe you love me. Oh, get your right. Life is too short. You may be here today and gone tomorrow. You might as well get what you want. So go on and live. Baby, go on and live. Tell it like it is. I'm nothing to play with. Go and find yourself a star. But I feel like it is. My time is too expensive, and I'm not your little boy.
Good evening, you're on the air.
Good evening.
Yes.
Good monologue.
Tongue
goes good with it.
Thank you.
I got a question for you. You were talking about, when you were talking about your show didn't air last night, for whatever reason, you talked about after your show is the disinformation show. Were you referring to the Dave Hinkson show?
Oh, yeah, without a doubt. That's the snake oil salesman.
I wonder if you could tell me what particular one of their guests with different disinformation people.
I didn't say the guests, I said the show.
Oh, the show itself.
They have some good guests. Some of the guests are really good.
Yeah, because I was kind of...
I'm talking about consistently the show.
Yeah, and
some of the products that they sell. I mean, you can go back to the turn of the century and follow those little wagons around with the guy that'd get out and sell you a bottle of dirt for $10. And you got about the same thing there.
Yeah, so I guess you've heard the David, what's his name, the guy that came up with that gold idea, the powdered gold. Is that what you're talking about?
Well, they started out with colloidal silver. Then they went to colloidal gold. Then they went to colloidal something else and colloidal something else. And, they could save an awful lot of time if they just put some colloidal dirt in a bottle. They'd have it all.
Yeah, they've got that other shirt that they're claiming is the Alchemist white powder gold.
Oh, yeah, and the Alchemist. Sure, uh-huh.
Yeah, but there is something to that. It's interesting that, I'm an ethnomycologist, and I've studied for years Amanita muscaria, and we know, and I've got thousands of documents to support the fact that the Amanita muscaria was actually the gold of alchemy. So
there was never any gold of alchemy. That's the biggest ruse of all time. Alchemy was an esoteric language to disguise the hidden religion of the mystery religion of Babylon. Nobody ever tried to change lead into gold.
Right, well, it was all about a spiritual process.
That's exactly right. You got it.
But there's also the prima materia, and that there is a substance, the Amanita muscaria, which is used for that. It's also the water of life, and it's also the tree of life and the tree of knowledge. And it
all relates to a spiritual, esoteric religion. It has absolutely nothing to do with real matter or changing real matter into something else.
Actually, it does have to do with real matter. There's, if you go back into the Hindu religion, one of the most profound works on the subject was done by Gordon Wass, and it's called Soma, Divine Mushroom of Immortality.
Yeah, and it's total crock of crap. I've already read it, researched it, everything. There's no substance to it whatsoever.
Oh, there is. I've studied it for 25 years.
Well, I'll tell you what. When you can come, I'll give you a chunk of lead, you can turn it into gold, and I'll believe you.
No, that was like you say, that's symbolic.
Yeah, so's all the rest of it.
But the transformation within yourself, it translates from the Vedas, the Soma mushroom. Then there was John Allegro that wrote the book.
Yeah, that's what I said. It's all a spiritual thing. It does not translate into material things.
No, it's physical. It's the manna. The manna that Christ says, I am the manna. I am the bread that came down from heaven. Eat of me and you shall give immortality.
That's right.
There's a real physical thing there.
Well, it's not a physical thing. It's a spiritual thing.
Well, that's what I'm sure all the Masons want you to think, and what everybody, all the disinformation specialists want you to think. But believe me, I've studied it for 25 years. I'm not just talking out of.
I've studied every aspect of all of it. I'm the first one that's ever documented and gone beyond anybody has ever gone. And I'm telling you right now, all of these things in reference to spiritual things has nothing to do with real substance, real things on this earth. It's all within.
What references are you talking about then? Which things did you study about?
Well, I would suggest you go back and get my series on the mystery schools. There's no way I can talk about all of that stuff in a 3 or 4 minute phone call. And by the way, you've been on much longer than you should be on because we've got to get to other callers. But I've covered it in many, many hours of this broadcast.
Well, I'm just kind of... hoping to enlighten you on another aspect of it that I've studied myself.
I think you're spitting in the wind. Until you can document it, like I do with what I talk about on this broadcast, then it's not. And you can't do it in a phone call. If you really want me to pay attention to what you're saying, put it in writing, document it, prove it, send it to me. If you're right, I'll call you and have you as a guest on this broadcast.
Yeah, well, I've got over 6,000 documents.
Well, do it.
It'll prove it.
No. Documents don't prove anything. Documents lead you to proof.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, nothing proves anything, really, then. Right?
Well, that's not true either.
Well, what proves it, then?
Oh, good night. When you start making statements like that, I know you're out in woo-woo land. You're in woo-woo, woo-woo, woo-woo. You're flying with the New Agers. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hi, Bill. Love yourself.
Right.
Kind of like the prior guy was trying to catch it in a tongue twist. I would have just ignored him. What do you know about the Knights Templar? How do they relate to all of this? It's a 13th degree of the Masons. Where do you go from there when you're a Templar?
Well, it depends upon which side of the scale you're on. If you're If you're in the Scottish Rite, the 13th degree is not the Templar. If you're in the York Rite, the 13th degree is the Knights Templar. And it is also the highest degree in the York Rite, this side of the veil. When you go behind the veil, of course, there are more degrees. In the Scottish Rite, the highest degree is the 32nd degree, and then you have a meritorious degree, which is the 33rd degree. To be in the Shriners, you either have to be a 32nd degree Freemason of the Scottish Rite or the 13th degree Freemason of the York Rite.
Which is Knights Templar.
Yes.
What do the Templars do? Are they involved with conspiracy? Do they go to their meetings and then rank into the CFR?
Well, it's just another degree within the whole scope of this mystery religion. And these degrees are actually methods of weeding out the people who will understand the symbology and who will play along with the game and can be trusted and then can be brought up to a higher rung in the ladder, so to speak, and given more responsibility as one of the 1,000 points of light to bring about the New World Order. It just so happens that the Knights Templar is the highest degree in the York Rite, and there is a degree Knights Templar in many of the other fraternal organizations, and there is also a Templar order with commanderies and all of these kinds of things. But this all comes from many, many centuries of developing these beliefs and honoring the orders and the men who furthered the hidden esoteric knowledge and guarded the secrets of the ages, so to speak, and brought the plan from generation to generation and made it work. The actual order of the Knights Templar were not a Catholic order, as everyone believes. They were commissioned on the Temple Mount in Jerusalem by an order called the Prior de Sion in 1310, and worked in secret for many years until 1110, not 1310. The year 1110, and they worked in secret for 8 years, and then were given as a public decree, made an order by the King of Jerusalem, and were given the task of finding the secrets of the Temple Mount. They explored all the caves and caverns and the history of the Temple Mount, and all of a sudden they had a lot of wealth, and nobody knows where it came from, even to this day. It's speculation. Some of us who have done a lot of research into that order think we know, and there's a pretty good chance that we're right, but it can't be proven, and so we don't go around saying what it is to everybody because we can't prove it. And then they pretended to be set up for the protection of the pilgrims who traveled from Europe to Jerusalem and then back to Europe again. And eventually they became so wealthy and so powerful that the Pope wanted in on this. He called the Grand Master of the Templars in to the Vatican and recognized formally their order and gave them as a badge of recognition the Red Cross that they wore upon their tunic. And they always carried a checkered flag with white and black checkers on it, which is the yin and the yang, the positive, the negative, the white, the black, the male, the female. Their symbol was two knights riding on one horse, which was supposed to symbolize the poverty and the sharing of their order. They were, in fact, the first known modern European communist order. They were the first world international bankers. Their fleet, when it was dispersed after the King of France and the Pope they thought they destroyed the order, but the only ones they got were some of the Templars in France, including the Grand Master Jacques de Molay. That fleet actually disappeared and became the pirates, flew the Skull and Bones. This all has to do with the movie Braveheart, with the term Braveheart. I could go on and on and on, but we don't have that much time. I hope that helps.
Okay, what temple were they investigating again? The Temple on the Mount?
No, they were investigating the Temple Mount. The temple the temple was already gone.
The rubbish they were going underneath.
Yes.
Where do present-day temples go from here? They go to the meetings? Do they try to get into politics? What's the benefit?
Well, it's not any longer the Templars. The Templars are just a degree in this vast organization, which is known overall as the Illuminati. All of these fraternal organizations, even though they seem to oppose each other at the lower levels, at the higher levels are one interlocking organization of adepts and initiates known as the Illuminati, or the Magi, or the Illumined Ones, or the Order, or the Brotherhood.
Okay. Thank you very much, Bill.
You're welcome.
Good luck. Bye-bye.
Oh, boy. I love questions like that. It's a lot of fun. 520-333-4578 is the number, if you're a new listener, or if you're an old listener and have forgotten the number. Good evening, you're on the air.
Cooper.
Yes.
Dan and Maryland, how you doing?
Good.
Look, I got a good book to recommend to the guy that just called, and it's out in the regular bookstore. You don't have to call and place an order someplace.
Okay.
It's called En Route to Global Occupation by Gary Kaw.
Yeah, we've talked about it on here several times.
Right, and otherwise, I got to correct you on something you said a few days ago. And I don't think it was a replay, but you mentioned something about, I think, Senate Bill 216 in Maryland. You remember that?
That must have been a rerun, because I don't remember.
That night didn't realize it was a rerun.
Yeah, all last week were reruns, and last night, if you heard anything, was a rerun. I don't know if anything was played or not. I couldn't get on the satellite.
I was listening when you got kicked off the other night. Mr. Glenn Denning's gun control wad got through this session, but we still got another shot. There's going to be a petition drive to get it on a referendum, and maybe we can get it voted out in November. So I hope if any other Marylanders listen, they'll keep their eye out for the petition and get that thing circulated. We need 3% of the registered voters to get it on a referendum.
Yep, go for it.
We will. Old line spirit ain't dead yet.
Good.
See ya.
520-333-4578 is the number.
I remember my first love affair. Somehow enough, the whole darn thing went wrong. And my mama had some great advice, so I thought I'd put it in the words of this song. I can still hear her saying, "Boy, oh, I see you sitting out there all alone, crying your eyes out, because the woman that you love is gone. Oh, don't be, not gonna be a whole lot of trouble in your life. Oh, so listen to me, get up off your knees, don't let me grow to cry." That's what she said. She made me feel like a clown. And a whole lot of girls looking for a good man like you. Oh, but you'll never meet a man to give up now and say your life is true. Then she said, "Oh, little strong survive. Oh, little strong survive.
Don't forget to call Swiss America Trading tomorrow or tonight, ladies and gentlemen, and thank them for sponsoring this broadcast, because if it hadn't been for them, for at least the last 3 years, you probably wouldn't have heard us. We carried the financial burden of this broadcast for as long as we could, literally sold everything we had to keep it on the air. Our motto in this family, we only have one rule, and that's trust in God and just do it once we have determined that that's the right thing to do. And then we go for it, and we know that if we're doing the right thing, then whatever we need is going to be made available for us, and that has never failed. It has never, ever failed. And So it is true. If you determine what you need to do and that it is the right thing and you put all your trust in God, I can bear faithful witness that God will provide for you without fail. Good evening. You're on the air. Good.
I caught the remark about Braveheart. Let me preface by saying I don't know a lot of things, and I've heard you talk about Hiram Abiff, and I know that there's some sort of connection with the presidents all the way up to George Bush and possibly Clinton. However, my question specifically is with the movie Braveheart and the mystery religions. I watched it as purely entertainment and was, you know, sort of aroused by, you know, the manly nature of taking care of freedom. But I'm hearing something else in what you're saying regarding that movie. Could you comment on it?
Well, we've already done, I think, 3 broadcasts just on Braveheart alone.
Oh, I'm sorry. Just that, and since that's the case, then I won't take any more of your time.
Yeah, it was just recently, too. But I will talk about one thing that we didn't cover in that broadcast, is that Robert the Bruce was actually the founder of what eventually became the Scottish Rite of Freemasonry. Freemasonry existed already, but he is the one who founded, along with the Templars who were escaping the Pope and the King of France. They fled to Scotland, which was the only place that they could go to where they would be accepted and not persecuted, and rallied around Robert the Bruce and ended up liberating Scotland, and he founded the Scottish Rite of Freemasonry and what is known as the Skull and Bones, and he is actually buried with his 2 thigh bones crossed beneath his skull in his crypt. Before he died, he gathered his faithful followers around him and told them to cut out his heart after he was dead, put it in a casket, and take it to Jerusalem and bury it in the sepulcher where Christ was also entombed. And so a couple of his faithful servants set out to do that with his heart in a small casket box. And most people don't understand where the name of the movie came from. On the way, they were attacked many times. They fought their way through, and then the last conflict that they were engaged in, they were overwhelmed, and they knew that they were overwhelmed. And one of them was wounded and couldn't ride into the battle. 2 of the others did, carrying the coffin, carrying Robert the Bruce's heart. And as they approached the enemy, he threw the casket with Robert the Bruce's heart in the air ahead of him toward the enemy and yelled, "Oh, brave heart," and then they entered the battle. The one who had stayed behind was the only one who survived. He recovered the casket with Robert the Bruce's heart off the battlefield. He never made it to Jerusalem. He carried it back to Scotland with him, and it is buried with Robert the Bruce.
And then can I assume that Hollywood knew what they were making when they made that?
Oh, absolutely, yes.
Very interesting. Thank you very much. I enjoy your show tremendously.
You're welcome. And thank you for calling. 520-333-4578 is the number. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hi, Bill. Gary from Connecticut.
Hello, Gary.
Get my radio? Okay, it's off. I heard your broadcast with Dr. Cuddy.
Yes.
Fabulous, fabulous. I have a book called Citizen Cone about Roy Cone, and I'd like to quote, "Morgenthau had it against me ever since I conducted an investigation into the delivery of U.S. money plates to the Russians. He hates my guts."
Yeah, that's absolutely right. They were delivered to the Russians. We had a headline story in Veritas about it. We've discussed it on this broadcast many times. Yeah, you're right, and that just it's another verification. I would like to ask you, if you will, to make a copy of that quote and make sure you write down exactly what it was contained in and send me that, if you would.
Citizen Cone, about Roy Cone.
Not on the air. You need to send me that in writing.
Okay.
Okay, if you will.
Can I fire a couple questions at you?
Sure.
Dr. Gene Scott, many years ago, he did so many broadcasts on the pyramid. Is he one of them?
Absolutely, he's one of them. In fact, Tom Valentine and Gene Scott have exactly the same philosophy, belong to the same organizations. Tom Valentine signed over the rights to all of his books on the pyramid to Dr. Gene Scott so that he could do those teachings on the broadcast.
Fabulous. I've been sucking books down like crazy. I read Dope Incorporated.
Uh-huh.
Incredible. Incredible.
Yeah.
I'm so ready. Well, critical of Lyndon LaRouche called The New American Fascism.
Lyndon LaRouche is a communist.
Yep. Is he really a communist, or is he just an opportunist?
No, Lyndon LaRouche is a communist.
Philosophy to fit whatever he thinks he can, you know, will propel him to power.
Nope, Lyndon LaRouche is a communist. He says whatever he needs to say to get a following and bring him to power. He is now disguising himself as a conservative.
I read that book about James Jesus Angleton.
Uh-huh.
He was a communist mole?
No, he was an Anglophile, British Israelist. He is a part of the British oligarchic Freemasonry Zionist group that have aligned themselves on that side of the fence against communism and the French Freemasonry.
Okay, because in that book he had a KGB officer, Golitsyn. Remember, you know, I mean, he catered to this guy for years and accepted his information, and this guy gave him nothing. Whereas Yuri Nosenko was a legitimate KGB defector, and what they did to this guy.
Well, you have to understand that they could not allow the Cold War to be won by either side. The whole Cold War was concocted in order to create the means of taxing huge amounts of money from the people of the world in order to develop the technology that they need in order to rule in the New World Order.
Another question. Who killed Officer Tippett? If it wasn't Lee Harvey Oswald, he was standing outside the depository.
I have no idea, but there is so much conflicting testimony with the witnesses with that scene there, I don't believe that it could have been Lee Harvey Oswald. Nor were any ballistics ever done on Lee Harvey Oswald's pistol to prove that he shot Officer Tippett.
And I'd like to say one thing to your audience. I'm out here in Connecticut. I grew up with a lot of Jews. I know a lot of Jews. And they don't know anything about this stuff. I mean, sure, there are Jews involved, but I mean, the just regular Jewish people, they're like anybody else. They're even more manipulated than we are about all this stuff.
You can say that again, and they're more easily manipulated.
What I can't understand is they know so much about the Holocaust and Hitler, and I mean, they cannot see it coming. They can't, it just bugs the hell out of me.
Well,
maybe.
That's history repeats itself.
Nobody else.
History repeats itself. Thank you for calling.
Okay, good night, Bill.
Good night. I don't know what it is with his phone, but people are cutting in and out, and I'm trying to figure out what it is. Maybe I'll find out. Good evening. You're on the air.
Yes, good evening, Bill.
Yes.
Comment on Braveheart, and I did not hear your shows on the movie. Something struck me as far as Mystery Schools with regard to the makeup that Mel Gibson wore on his face before going into battle. I wonder if you've covered anything about that.
No, I haven't. And as far as I know, I don't know any connection with the Mysteries with that makeup.
Well, let me give you a little bit of background on that.
Okay, go ahead.
Note that he had his face half painted in blue. And going back into Theosophy, and I don't know if you've done much work in that, Madame Blavatsky and
yes,
that area. Blue was the color of the blue race, who were reported to be the guardians of the Ark of the Covenant. And one of the theories had it that it was taken to Scotland for safekeeping.
Uh-huh.
And the blue race were supposed to be the race that guarded that. And hence the term Blue Bloods, the British Royal Crown, all that area. Mel Gibson's face was painted blue in the movie, half blue. Also, in one of the battle scenes, there was a star over his eye, outlined over his eye.
Mm-hmm.
And this relates to another one of the, the tenets of Theosophy, which is, they take this from the Bible, there's a phrase in there, let your eye be single and your purpose be whole.
Uh-huh.
And this goes back to the some of the temple initiations of the single eye, the pineal, the eye single.
Mm-hmm.
And I was just wondering if you'd seen any of that, or if that had occurred to you when you looked at the movie.
I've read all of that. There's so much symbology in that movie that you can't possibly cover it all.
That one really jumped out at me.
But I had not made the connection between the blue makeup on his face and the blue race, and that's a very good connection that you've made.
Yeah, that single eye, let your eye be single and your purpose be whole, it's a real interesting thing, and I just wonder how many more little bits of this are there to be uncovered. I think I've seen the movie once. I don't think you can take even 20% of it in the first time.
Well, the movie is full of symbolism and esoteric hidden meaning, and if you really watch it over and over and over again, you'll pick up on it. But you have to be astute in this hidden religion and in the symbology of the religion and in the actual dogma and the esoteric meaning.
Do you see any larger overall negative purpose to the release of that movie, or the timing of that movie, as far as what the average person will get from it?
Oh yes, you have to understand that one of the purposes of all that's happening today is to instigate or provoke a revolution in America.
Right.
If they can provoke the American people to revolt against the government, they will be justified in destroying anybody that they declare an enemy of the government, and in the eyes of the sheeple out there, they will be fully justified in taking whatever measures they have to take to preserve what the sheeple believe is really the government. And so many provocateurs are out there, many Trojan horses. I've identified many of them on this broadcast. I have urged people to form militias, but not ever to talk of revolution, or to think of revolution, or plan for revolution,
yeah,
but to train and be prepared to protect your families and your communities for when this takes place, because it will take place. There will be a breakdown of law and order and of society as we know it, and the only hope to make sure that order is maintained and that we come out of it and are able to restore constitutional Republican government is if the militias fulfill their purpose, and not some purpose that they think that they're supposed to fulfill, brought on by the false teachings of provocateurs and Trojan horses.
100% agree, and I think you really are onto something there. A couple of other things that you've mentioned over the past couple of weeks, Lucent Technologies, the recent IPO for that. I've seen the prospectus, and their symbol is the rising sun, Horus, the rising sun.
Yes.
The other thing that's interesting is with the Freeman situation, Randy Weaver obviously hung out there like bait on a string to say, if you guys don't want to play ball, here's an example of what happens.
Yeah.
Fascinating times that we live in, aren't they?
They certainly are.
Thanks a lot.
You're welcome. Thank you for calling.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, folks, I've gone deeper into this than anybody else ever has. I've exposed more of it to you than anybody else has ever even dreamed of or ever even scratched into. And I've told you what's going to happen. I have never been wrong, except once. Only once have I ever been wrong on a prediction. And that was when I said Manuel Noriega will not be tried in a court of law and put in jail in the United States, because he's the head of a foreign country. And it can't happen. I mean, it's impossible to happen. You can't go to a foreign country and kidnap their president and do that. But I had not realized at that time how far along they were in the New World Order that they could actually get away with that. It's against all concepts of international agreements, law, the precedents set throughout the history of the world, so on and so forth. Good evening. You're on the air.
Yes. Bill Cooper?
Yes.
This is Elaine from Grand Junction, Colorado. I just wanted to say thank you for your program. I recently woke up about 5 to 6 weeks ago, I'd say. My husband's listened to you for about a year and a half now.
Uh-huh.
And has tried to get me to listen to you. I've listened to you on and off. Since then, we received your talks, and we've gotten the old Pale Horse and the treason papers, the intelligence tapes, and there's something else.
The whole works, huh?
Yes, the whole works. Yeah, but I just wanted to say thank you very much.
Well, good.
I wanted to encourage you to keep on going.
And thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
This is what I think of you. So take that.
Prettier than all the world. And I'm so proud, I'm so proud, I'm so proud of you. You're only one kind of girl. And I'm so proud, so proud, I'm so proud of you. I'm so proud of being loved by you. And it would hurt.
Good evening, you're on the air.
Hey, Bill.
Yes.
David, Louisiana.
Hello.
I noticed in Veritas that you reprinted an article out of the Counselor newspaper. Is this the Counselor from Shreveport, Louisiana, from Ned Touchstone of about 20 years ago?
I'm not sure. I don't know where it was printed. It was an old, wrinkled up, stained copy that somebody sent to us. And that article just jumped out and needed to be printed, so we did.
Yeah, he had a great paper there about 20 years ago. He had a lot of good information. It was ahead of his time, I thought. Let me ask you about your opinion, which I value highly, of the John Birch Society.
My investigation into the John Birch Society has told me that it is an organization set up under the Hegelian dialectic in order to provide patriots with the feeling that someone is speaking for them when really no one is. They discourage action of any kind except writing your congressman. They publish a lot of books and they do a lot of things and they invite speakers to their meetings, but they are absolutely impotent. They do nothing whatsoever. The individual members, some of them are very active and do a lot of things. They're incredible, wonderful people. But the organization itself is a, in fact, they have even barred, taken membership away from people who have become active in some areas of patriotism that they don't consider to be proper.
Okay. Thank you very much.
So I'm not telling you not to join the John Birch Society. Just be prepared for them to tell you that writing your congressman and voting is the only answer. And I'm here to tell you that that's no answer at all anymore. That's not going to do it. You have some influence with your vote on a local level. Beyond that, you have none whatsoever. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hi, Bill. This is Joe out in Ramona, California.
Hello.
Back. Missed you.
Thank you.
I found something today. Puffing and puffing here. Hold on. I found something today. I was pointing out something's garage where somebody had passed away.
Yeah.
It says here, my Masonic record presented by the San Diego Scottish Rite Body. And it lists the tree of, you know, all the different orders and the numbers and all that. Would you like a copy of it?
Certainly.
Okay, I'll send it to you. Now, I have something that belongs to you. I ordered that tape of the Waco Children.
Yes.
The first time you announced it.
Uh-huh.
And the Postal Service lost it. So I ordered another one recently. When I finally got it, you sent me an extra tape, a JFK tape.
Well?
It doesn't belong to me. It belongs to you, and I want to know where to send it.
Well, I give it to you. How's that?
Well, I've already got one. Thank you.
Well, give it to somebody that needs it.
Okay. We'll do that. Now, is there a new address for sending stuff by UPS to you?
By UPS? Well, if you send by UPS, you can send it to, golly, I don't know yet. Let me figure that out and I'll announce it on the air.
I have some other goodies. You know, I work at the, top shop down there, the department.
Uh-huh.
And I have some magazines I'd like to send you.
Okay.
Some interesting stuff, and I just don't want to send it to the regular postal service. If you could you announce tomorrow night if you think of it?
If I can figure it out, yeah.
Okay. That sounds good. I'll let somebody else try and get in.
Okay.
Thanks a lot, Bill.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
520-333-4578 is the number. And Good evening. You're on the air.
Hi, Mr. Cooper. It's Michael in Canada calling.
Hello, Michael.
Long time no talk.
Oh, that Michael.
Yeah. How are you, sir?
Has been a long time.
I just wanted to call and wish you all the best to yourself and your family.
Well, thank you.
And your new addition. And to tell your listeners how consistent this program and Veritas has been since I started listening to you about almost 3 years now. And I hope more Canadian listeners start to pay attention and wake up a little bit. It's not too much to ask. Unfortunately, it is. That's about all I have to say. You haven't deviated from your standpoint. I totally respect your work, as you know, and it's always been consistent.
Well, thank you. And we're very thankful for the help that you gave us a couple of years ago.
Well, there will be more. I have been very busy, and as you know, you get tied up with your own projects, and it's hard to communicate long distance sometimes. But I want to give you more of the Canadian perspective. And
yeah, you guys are just about down the tubes, huh?
Just about. It's not too far away, and the province I'm in, Ontario, has now been nicknamed Onscario.
Uh-huh.
And there's good reason for that. There is economic manipulation like you wouldn't believe, and it's tragic is what it is.
Yeah.
And it's a lie. And the people here are so apathetic that I don't really have time anymore to even try to educate other than myself. You know, because the majority of people, they couldn't care less.
Well, Michael, you know, the Canadians were never in their history really known for having a whole lot of patriotism.
No, not at all.
And I've never been able to figure that out. Maybe it's, I just really don't know. Maybe it's because they're part of the British Commonwealth and they really don't have any great love for England.
That's part of it. And when you had a communist by the name of Pierre Trudeau as prime minister, and all the socialist policies that Canadians have been reared on, we're now seeing the effect of that. And it's massive debt, a government that is almost bankrupt. I don't know if you heard this story. Our prime minister had a break-in at 24 Sussex Drive, and he was held at bay with a jackknife. It took the Royal Canadian Mounted Police almost 15 minutes to respond. That's the kind of security we have up here, I guess, unless that was just done to discredit our RCMP. Our whole military has been discredited.
Well, it's a lot faster than any police department I know of in the United States.
Really?
Really.
But the chief executive officer, you know what I mean?
Well, that's here we have other organizations that, like the Secret Service, that
sure.
The president is never alone.
Right.
Anyway, we're out of time, Michael. I'm certainly glad to hear from you. I didn't know what happened to you or anything. I haven't heard from you for a long time, but thanks for calling.
Alive and kicking, and I'll talk to you soon.
Okay.
Good night, Bill. Good night. Bye-bye.
And folks, good night. God bless you all. And for those of you who may have just heard this program for the first time tonight,
Try me.